Do is turn it on to the demons. Lean on him. Good evening, Community Praise Church. I want to welcome you tonight to our Candlelight Communion service. As we look forward to 2022, we enter into this new year with courage, with confidence. We enter into the new year with anticipation. I know 2021 was a year full of trials, a year full of challenges, and even tragedies for some of us. But we also have to acknowledge tonight that it was a year full of triumphs, a year of victory, a year where we saw the blessings of God poured out on our church, on our families, and on our lives. And I know that this setting is a little bit different. I know that we were expecting a different annual communion experience tonight, but God's grace is still sufficient, Community Praise Church. God's goodness is immeasurable. His mercies are new every morning. And tonight we have the opportunity to experience communion in an intimate setting with our families or our friends in our own homes, to be able to spend this time even virtually together is a blessing. And we're looking forward to what God will do in our lives tonight. I invite you to bow your heads together as we pray. Our Father and our God, we are grateful. Grateful that you have carried us safely through another year. We began 2021 with different expectations, and we're ending 2021 with great hope. Moving into 2022, knowing that you are still on the throne, come what may, your goodness is still available. Your grace is still sufficient. Your mercies are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness to us, O God. Our hearts, O Lord, are open to the leading of the Holy Spirit tonight. We want to hear from you. We want to experience your presence, and we want to be drawn closer to your side. And so, God, move from heart to heart, from house to house, from living room to living room, phone to phone, tablet to tablet, television to television, that we would experience the outpouring of the Holy Spirit tonight. And we ask it in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Welcome, CPC. Good evening, Community Praise Church.
In his name.
to that time to spend just a few moments in the Word of God tonight. I want to share something with you from Matthew chapter 26, and again, I'm reading from the clear word, Matthew chapter 26, beginning at verse 20. The Bible says, "When evening came, Jesus and the other disciples arrived at the place, and soon they were all seated and ready to eat. As they ate together, Jesus said, 'Only a few more hours now, then one of you will betray me.' The disciples couldn't believe what they heard. Each one asked, 'Lord, you're not talking about me, are you?' After they had all asked, he said, 'The one you saw dipping his bread in the bowl when I did is the one who will betray me. All of this my father knew ahead of time, and the prophets predicted, yet the one who will betray me is doing it of his own free will. In one way, it would have been better had he not been born, because he's only bringing about his own destruction.' When Judas, who was sitting next to Jesus," hear me now, I want you to get this. "When Judas, who was sitting next to Jesus, heard this, he felt sure that Jesus knew about the arrangement he had made with the priest. Yet to make sure, Judas quietly asked, 'Master, are you referring to me?' Jesus whispered back, 'Yes, I am.'" I want you to hear that one more time. Judas, wanting to make sure, asked quietly, "Master, are you referring to me?" Jesus said, "Yes, I am." Then Jesus prayed the Passover blessing and broke the bread, giving a piece to each of the disciples. He said, "Let's eat this bread, because together it symbolizes what I'm going to do for you. I want you to think of it as my body." Next, he took a cup of unfermented wine, offered the Passover prayer of thanksgiving, and said, "I want each of you to drink from this cup. This pure juice represents my blood, and the bread represents my body that I will give for the sins of the world. I will not drink of the fruit of the vine again until we sit down together in the kingdom of heaven to celebrate." Then they sang a hymn and left for the Mount of Olives. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we need a word from you. Give us understanding and give us clarity. In Jesus' name, amen. We ended 2020 last year with great anticipation, ended it with hope, hoping that 2021 would fare better than 2020 did, hoping that the virus would somehow go away, hoping that we wouldn't see as many deaths or funerals, hoping that the world would change, life would get better, things would improve. We hung our hat on the hope that 2021 would be better than 2020. And somehow we discovered over the course of time that we shouldn't have been asking for a better year. We should have been drawing closer to the Lord. We didn't need necessarily a better year than 2020. What we really needed was to look toward the return of Jesus Christ. Because see, the reality is, we don't have to see a better year in 2021. And I just want to make this clear at this very moment. We don't have to see a better year in 2022. What we do need to see is better relationship with Jesus. I want you to get this thing in your heart. I don't need a better 2022. What I do need is a better relationship with Jesus. The reason I say that, let me pause parenthetically, and the reason I say that is because Paul reminded us in Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." And when Paul said that, Paul was establishing not that he could accomplish more or that he could achieve more when he submitted his ways before God. What Paul was saying, when you look back into verses 11 and 12, is that I can endure anything that I go through because I have a relationship with God. It's not a question of needing a better situation. What it means is, when I have a relationship with God, when I have the Spirit of God living in me, the situation doesn't have to change because something has shifted inside of me. And so even if the year doesn't get better, I want you to get this, if the year doesn't get better, I'm still better because God is still great. Let me make sure you get this. If 2022 gives us more of the same, I'm still better because God is still great. It is not that we're looking for a better scenario, a better situation. What I need is a closer walk, just a closer walk with Thee. I need a closer walk with Jesus, and in that closer relationship with the Savior, I'm better because He's still good. I want you now to dig into Matthew chapter 26. You see here in Matthew chapter 26, Jesus is bringing His disciples together for a final meal before the crucifixion. The Bible says that they go into the upper room of a man's house, they've set up the table, and Jesus does a few things in this experience that we have to notice and find this for which we find spiritual significance. We won't touch all of it tonight. I simply want you to see a few things that Jesus does. He first washes the disciples' feet. He takes off his robe, wraps it around himself, gets down, and begins to wash the disciples' feet. It is an example of humility that the disciples have to now mimic. They have to embrace. Because understand, as followers of Jesus, our responsibility at communion is not only to humble ourselves before God, but to humble ourselves before one another. And in order to do that, we have to truly embrace what it is to have communion. I know it's tough because we don't always get along. We don't see eye to eye. In fact, we value differences. We value what makes us unique and what makes us different from the rest of the throng. But understand, at communion, we are all bought with a price, bought with the blood of the Lamb. We are all under the banner of Jesus Christ. We need the Savior. There is no distinction, no Jew, no Greek, no male, no female, rich or poor, black or white. We are all one in Jesus. And in washing one another's feet, it is the expression of divine, heartfelt humility before God and one another. Jesus washed feet. I want you to let that sink in. Jesus washed feet. Whew. I know that we want to be leaders and we want to get everything done and we want to be the one that everybody goes to. We want to go to a place where everybody knows our name. But understand, Jesus washed feet. It is the measure of greatness. Jesus washed feet. This isn't about a sermon He preached. This isn't about miracles He performed. In this moment, Jesus is washing the feet of sinners. He's washing the feet of the one who will betray Him, the one who will deny Him, the others who will desert Him. He's washing the feet of those who will break His heart. That's humility. That's what this communion experience means. The communion experience means that we must humble ourselves before those who will break our hearts. It's easy to humble ourselves before those that we like, to humble ourselves before those that praise us and those that support us and those that have our back and those that give us good gifts. But how do you humble yourself before those who you know will break your heart? That's communion. Jesus will first wash the feet of the disciples, but then I want you to see what happens in Matthew chapter 26. Jesus says, in verse 21, as they ate together, Jesus said, only a few more hours now, then one of you will betray me. Eesh. Here's where things begin to get a little bit tough. Jesus says, only a few more hours, and one of you will betray me. At the table, at the communion table, Jesus confronts sin. He's washed all of their feet. They're sitting at the table. In fact, in these times, they're reclining on one another. Their bodies are literally touching as they recline on one another and they eat in this last supper together. Jesus now, as they are dipping the bread and as they are eating this communion, this community meal, Jesus says, only a few more hours and one of you is going to betray me. All of the disciples who will at some point disappoint the Savior are looking at one another saying, Lord, is it I? Are you talking about me? Judas, knowing the arrangement he's already made with the priests, now whispers in the ear of Jesus, Jesus, are you talking about me? And the Bible says Jesus whispers back, yes, I am. At the communion experience, Jesus confronts sin. All year long, we've been covered by the grace of God. We've been followed by the power of God. The Holy Spirit has been our guide and our covering and our shield. At every turn, we have experienced the loving, watchful care of the Lord. The challenge is we've also made mistakes at every turn. 2021 has not been a perfect year for us. We've had days where we dropped the ball, days where we were discouraged and depressed, days where we weren't as faithful as we could have been, days where I just didn't live up to the standard that Jesus has set before me. And at the table, I'm reminded of my sins. I'm confronted with my iniquity. I'm confronted with my shortcomings. I am confronted with all of my mistakes. And it's at this table that Jesus is speaking to his disciples and says, one of you is going to betray me. And in the very next verse, look down. After he says, yes, Judas, it's you, verse 26 tells us that Jesus prayed the Passover blessing, broke the bread, giving a piece to each of the disciples. He said, let's eat this bread together because it symbolizes what I'm going to do for you. I want you to think of it as my body. Listen to what Jesus does. This is what fascinates me about Matthew chapter 26. As he's sitting around the table with these imperfect men, as he calls out the sins or the sin of Judas, as he says, one of you is going to betray me, he in the very next breath now breaks bread, prays the prayer of blessing over the Passover meal, and gives each of them a piece and says, I want you to think of this as my body and be reminded of what I'm about to do for you. He calls out sin in one breath and then offers eternal life through his sacrifice in the next. Understand that communion is the same. Communion, while confronting us with sin, is also offering us salvation. While confronting us with our iniquities, it's also offering us eternal life. It is begging us to come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest for your soul. It is in that moment that I am, one, confronted with sin, and two, offer the gift of salvation. There is no condemnation at the table. He says, yes, Judas, you're going to betray me. He's looking at Peter and knowing that, Peter, you're going to deny me. Looking at John, the beloved, and saying, knowing that John is going to desert him. But in the same breath, he's offering them salvation. He moves in one moment from confronting sin to offering eternal life. Communion is the same. Communion in one breath confronts our humanity, our sinful weaknesses, our tendency towards selfishness. And in the very next breath, offers us the answer to all of our cares, Jesus, eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus washes the feet of the disciples. He confronts their sin. He offers salvation and promises a glorious reunion. In fact, at the end of this, Jesus says, I want you to take this bread and this cup, and I want you to realize that I'm not going to drink of the fruit of the vine, verse 29, again until we sit down together in the kingdom of heaven to celebrate. And then the Bible says that they went out together and sang a hymn. He says, I'm not going to eat or drink this meal again until we do it together. He promises sinners that you'll be reunited with me. He promises us, even though he has to confront our sin at the table, he promises us eternal life at that same table, and then promises, if you will allow me to give you eternal life, then we will be reunited in the earth made new. Jesus moves in this passage from confronting betrayal to offering salvation. And here's the truth of it all. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We have all denied him with our actions. We've all not lived right. We haven't forgiven others. We haven't loved our neighbor. We haven't done as we ought. All of us have sinned, but all of us are forgiven. All have sinned, but all are forgiven and all are redeemed. Hallelujah! All are redeemed. This is the joy of the communion experience. We throw around that word redeemed all the time, and I looked it up. I wanted to know exactly what redemption means. And the word redeemed is defined as to buy back, to get or win back, to free from what distresses or harms, to free from captivity by payment of ransom. All of this is to redeem. We have been bought with a price. We've been purchased by the blood of the Lamb, bought back from sin by the sacrifice of Jesus. And even though this table may confront my weakness, this table also offers me his strength. And it offers you his strength too. I pray that this communion experience would transform your life, that you would know moving into 2022, I have shortcomings, I have failed, but great is the mercy of God. I have sinned, but great is his forgiveness. I've made mistakes, but great is his redemption, because you are bought with a price. Let's bow our heads together. Father in heaven, thank you for the reminder that we are purchased by your blood. Thank you for the reminder that we are bought with a price. That God, you have covered us with your own body. That you have redeemed us with your own blood. And that while our sin is confronted at the table, our sin is also forgiven at the table. Thank you for all that you've done. In Jesus' name, amen. I pray that you've been blessed so far. I know that I have. Now's the time for our communion service. And here at the Community Praise Church, our communion experience is an open communion experience. We invite you, no matter if you're a member of our church or not, to gather together to partake in this sacred experience where we experience the sacrifice of Jesus Christ for our sins. The communion experience is a time where we're reminded that we were bought with a price, that we're valuable in the sight of God, but also that we desperately need the Lord, that we're not perfect, that we have flaws, and no matter how good we think we are nothing without the blood of Jesus. We find its origins in the Passover experience of Exodus, and we move further as we see Jesus partake in this Passover experience with his disciples in the Gospels. That communion experience is birthed from the idea that we've been passed over, that the judgment of God, the wrath of God has passed over us because of the blood of Jesus Christ. And so once again, we invite you, no matter if you're a member of the Community Praise Church or not, to participate in this communion experience with us. God bless you. from 1 Corinthians 11, verses 23 to 26. The Bible says, I received direct instructions from the Lord on how to celebrate communion, which I want again to pass on to you. The night before Christ was crucified, he took some unleavened bread, and after he had blessed it, he broke it, passed it to his disciples, and said, break off a piece for yourself. And as you eat, think of it as my body, which will soon be broken for you. When I'm gone, this will remind you of me. Let's bow our heads. Our Father and our God, we're grateful for the sacrifice of Christ, grateful for the broken body of our Savior, for the sacrifice of the Messiah. And God, I pray that in this moment as we partake in this bread, that Lord, you would transform this moment into something sacred, something powerful that transforms us. Thank you for the forgiveness of sins, and thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's commune together. Amen. Reading on, the Bible says, then he took the cup of grape juice, blessed it, passed it to his disciples, and said, this pure juice represents the fulfillment of God's covenant through my blood. When you drink it, remember what I've done for you. Every time you get together to eat this bread and drink this juice, you should recall the last days of my life until I come. Let's pray. Oh God, we're so grateful tonight for the cleansing stream, the blood of the Lamb. We're grateful for that precious blood of Jesus that cleanses, it washes us from sin. And tonight as we take this juice, God, I pray that we would be reminded that our salvation cost heaven everything. But when devotion cost Christ all, he was still faithful to the call. Thank you for your death for us and for your life of intercession. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's commune together. Amen. God is certainly good to us, and we have reason to be grateful tonight. Thank you. blessed tonight. Thank you so much for joining us, Community Praise Church. I pray that you've been blessed tonight. It is always a joy to be able to participate in our year-end communion service. And I know that this was a little bit different tonight, but I pray that you've still experienced the intimate presence of God in your homes, wherever you are. Special thank you to our musicians, to our band, our singers, everyone who worked so hard to make sure that even a virtual communion could be so powerful for us. Thank you to our media team and to Chris and everybody who always works behind the scenes to make sure that ministry is meaningful. And thank you to each of you for your faithfulness all year long, for continuing to seek God in your lives and continuing to support the ministry of CPC. And as is our custom, every year we come down to this annual year-end communion experience and we ask that you give a very special gift, that you reach down deep, and that you give a special gift to our benevolent fund. That fund that we use to help people that are broken and hurting, who are struggling to provide for their needs, struggling to pay bills or buy groceries, or any other need that they may have. And it's at this time every year that we always ask, we petition each and every one of you to dig down deep and to sacrifice and to give a special offering to that benevolent fund. You can do that even online this year by going to cpcsda.org/give. And there you can give especially to our benevolent fund. And we're so blessed, so thankful that you're willing to do that. I pray that you've been blessed tonight. And finally, we will be rebroadcasting a powerful service tomorrow morning. And so we're looking forward to that, tomorrow afternoon, I should say. And we're looking forward to that. Join us at 12 noon as usual for a powerful worship experience as we start 2022 with the presence of God. I pray that you would seek him with all your heart and that when you find him, you would share him with the world around you. And as you go, tell the world about Jesus. Tell them about his love. God bless you.